What I want to talk about today is what Data Guard can do for you in addition to the standard functionality of providing disaster recovery facilities. And what this is about is gaining more value from your DR systems than just DR. I never forget a discussion, if you can call it a discussion rather than an argument, that I had almost the first time I set up Data Guard. This was back with 9i. The client I was working for had won a contract to run the call center for a multinational company. And one condition of the contract was that the database should be data guarded, and I've been subcontracted to set this up for them. Now, the person managing this contract kept coming up with comments like, it's ridiculous that I have to spend $500,000 on that box that's just sitting there in the corner doing nothing. And I tried to explain to him that it wasn't doing nothing. It was the reason he had a job, but he wouldn't accept this. And to this day, I come across this attitude quite frequently, normally from financial people. They find it hard to accept that a data guard system is actually worth having purely for data recovery, for giving you zero data loss and zero downtime. Well, it won't actually give you zero downtime. There will be a short switchover, but certainly zero data loss. And what I want to talk about today is facilities that will help in such situations, introducing ways in which you can extract business value from your standby databases beyond the disaster recovery aspects. And this may make it easier to motivate the introduction of Data Guard. It may even make it easy to motivate the upgrade from Standard Edition to Enterprise Edition. But one way or another, this is about ways of extracting more value from your Data Guard environment in addition to the high availability facilities. What we're going to do is open the database read-only. We're going to open the database read-write. And at the end, we'll even open the database in what we call the read-mostly mode, which is a particularly nice way for bringing your standbys into use. But throughout all this, I have to emphasize, don't ever forget, the core reason for Data Guard is protecting against data loss, protecting against downtime, and everything else should be viewed as a bonus. But that bonus can be huge. And what you can get out of these extra facilities should be techniques for improving performance of the primary by offloading work from the primary, improving performance of queries by running them against the standby that is, in, to a certain extent, optimized for the purpose, and perhaps even reducing the need for Oracle licenses by opening the standby database in a manner in which one system can provide multiple purposes. Perhaps it can protect your data while simultaneously running applications. And as we go through this, of course, I'll be doing demonstrations and so on. Now, those of you who have been with us before will know that I like nothing better than falling flat on my face while doing live demonstrations, but they really are important because anyone can show you just a set of PowerPoint slides, and I will, I hope, be able to demonstrate that we really can do what we say we're doing. But before I move on to the facilities that I want to concentrate on, I do want to spend just a few minutes of what is supposed to be revision. And this is what Data Guard actually works, the functioning of Data Guard in a normal or standard environment. Now, this is what one might call assumed knowledge, so I'm going to be very quick over on this. But if any of you would like a bit more information, send in a question, and assuming there's time, we'll cover it. Now, so how does Data Guard function? Well, when you enable Data Guard, you have two or more databases, and the environment I've set up here, I've actually got three databases. I've got one database, which I've called London, and if we look at the London database, we see that London is my primary database, and I've configured two others. Yes?
We're not seeing you.
We're just seeing your slide. Okay. In that case, I'll rebroadcast. Is that better? I'm sorry about that. I've got three databases here. My London database is my primary. My Berlin database is one physical standby. And I created a third one, ready for when I break one of the existing ones, which is Madrid. And that too is a physical standby. So I've got one primary propagating changes to two physical standbys. So, redo on the primary is generated absolutely as normal. So there's no change to the redo generation at all when you implement data guard. You know, your end users, their sessions write change vectors into the log buffer, and the log writer flushes the change vectors, the online logs, in near as damn it real time. And when you say commit, of course, it is real time. What does change on the primary is we add transport services, which may be synchronous or asynchronous. And those transport services, if we show parameter log archive dest 1, log archive dest 1 I have not set. By default, that will be my disk-based destination for the local archives. Log archive dest 2, I've configured to send the redo to the Berlin database. And log archive dest 3, I've configured to send redo to the Madrid database. How is that redo actually being transmitted? Well, if we look at we see I have additional processes, LogWriter network slave processes, and they are writing the data to the remote destination. I could join to another column or to another table to find out which one it is, but two of them are writing because I'm writing to two databases. And right now I am transmitting block 54,248 of log file switch sequence 29. Time goes on and we already have a small advance and we can see the data being transmitted in real time. So redo is generated as normal, but we add on transport services. Then we have the apply services. On the standby databases, here we have the Berlin standby, for example. If we look at what's happening here, we see that I have a process, the MRP, managed recovery process, which is applying redo. It's extracting the redo received, and right now it's applying block 54291 of sequence 29. Yes, so we've already advanced on there, applying that. And the RFS, the remote file service, that's the process that will be receiving redo. So if I do some work here, anything at all really, create table T1 and select star from all users, that should have kicked off some reaction here. Oh yes, it's now just been receiving that much. It's gone up to 89 already. That data will already have come across and been applied. The apply, I was using the managed recovery process, which is for physical standbys. That's redo apply through recovery. And it is quite simply recovery, as in recover database or recover data file, done at the block level. Purely for completeness, the alternative type of standby database is, of course, the logical standby, which applies with streams applies data with streams technology. The streams technology will be processing the redo stream and from it reverse engineering equivalent DML statements. I'm not going to talk about that today. That would be too large a topic and we'll deal with that on another day. Now, next slide of revision, the data flow. Oops, my apologies. The data flow, the log buffer is read on the primary by LogWriter network slave processes, in my case two network slaves because I'm directing data to two standbys. The network slave writes across SQLNet or Oracle Nets, as we should call it nowadays, to remote file servers, and that is a normal logged on session. The LogWriter network slave logs on through a listener to the remote database. The remote database listener spawns a server process which becomes the RFS process, usually spawns several because we may want to parallelize the reception of redo. The RFS, the remote file service on the standby, receives the redo and writes to standby log files. The apply services, in my case MRP, will read the standby log files, extract the change vectors, and apply them to data files. In logical standby, streams processes reverse engineer the change vectors into equivalent DML. And finally, on the standby databases, archive processes will generates archive logs from the standby logs as they fill. So we'll end up with archive logs in both the primary, where there's no real change to the operation at all apart from launching LNS processes, and archive logs will also exist on the standby log files. finally, the conclusion of Data Guard. I did promise this would only be a few minutes of revision. MAA, Maximum Availability Architecture. The Maximum Availability Architecture is Oracle Corporation's preferred option for zero data loss and 100% uptime. The zero data loss is guaranteed by Data Guard, and it really is zero data loss under any circumstances if you configure it appropriately. 100% uptime guaranteed by RAC, well, that's being slightly naughty in the definition of uptime. I always like to warn clients of this, that 100% uptime, yes, in terms of the database remains open, but bear in mind, not necessarily 100% uptime from the user's point of view. Sessions may freeze for a while, but in principle, maximum availability is one or more, is a RAC's database protected by a RAC's data guard. And for maximum availability, we include automatic failover based on the data guard broker. So the whole process of failover is automated. It's very effective. It's also very expensive. And we would love to set up maximum availability architecture for you. But it does cost a lot of money in terms of licenses, in terms of hardware, because it's largely based on redundant systems. And redundant systems is what in this seminar I want to get away from. I want to start bringing those data guard systems into use.
John, quick question in the queue. You mentioned sessions, user experience might freeze. Can you expand on that? Any experience with that? How long might the freeze be, as you said?
There are two points to consider here. If you're working in RAC, your session will be against one instance. If that one instance fails, there's what Oracle likes to call a brownout. When you lose an instance in a cluster, the entire cluster will freeze. The freeze may be a matter of seconds, single-digit seconds, and during those single-digit sessions, single-digit second period, perhaps 3 seconds, the cluster reconfigures itself. Only after that can sessions fail over to a surviving instance, and sessions already against that surviving instance wake up. So there's a short, your session will appear to hang for a few seconds. If, however, your cluster is really big, if it is 8 instances and they all have 100 gigabyte SGAs, you're going to notice that freeze. It could be a few minutes, single digit minutes, but you're going to notice it. The other problem is with failover to data guard, failover to a data guard standby database. That can be initiated. Well, you might choose to initiate it. The default for automatic failover is 30 seconds. I happen to think that's too short, and I would normally want to extend that to 1 minute or 2 minutes. The reason for that, by the way, is that you wouldn't want some minor network problem to happen and wham, all your databases switch over to Bogota. You would want a delay long enough to handle short-term transient problems. So you probably would want a couple of minutes delay before you initiate the failover. Having initiated the failover, there may well be a few minutes delay longer before the data guard physical standby is actually activated and sessions can transfer across to it. So delay should be single-digit minutes in the worst case.
Very nice, John. And that term brownout is somewhat catchy and descriptive. So it a little bit depends on configuration, I would say, and how much money you've spent and who's set up your configuration. And as John said, we would love to set up the configuration for you. John, another quick question in the queue. Does Data Guard require a separate license?
Right. Now, Data Guard is Enterprise Edition only. You do have to license every machine. So, yes, every machine has to be licensed, but as long as you already have Enterprise Edition licenses, there's no extra. The alternative that some sites have to work with, of course, is Standard Edition licenses. Now, with Standard Edition licenses, go back a few slides. With Standard Edition licenses, there are no transport services, there are no apply services. So, with a Standard Edition environment, you generate redo as normal on the primary database, but then you, the DBA, in conjunction with your system administrators, have to be responsible for transport. So a script-based system using a combination, usually a combination of SQL scripts and shell scripts, has to be designed to transfer archive logs from the primary database to the standby database. And on the standby database side, more scripts, again, usually using a combination of SQL scripts and shell scripts, have to apply the redo. So there is no extra license, but if you are not using Enterprise Edition licenses, you have to set up transport and apply manually, which is no big deal. We've done it, and the transmission would normally be perhaps every 10 minutes, because it's based on archive logging, and I would not want to force the generation of archive log more frequently than, say, every 10 minutes. And then the apply is through applying archive logs. Well, that will be pretty much as soon as they arrive. So there's no extra license as such, but if you don't have Enterprise Edition licenses, we have to provide scripted solutions for transport and apply.
Great. Thank you very much, John. Just I wanted to put it in the chat as a response to a question. Normally ship every 10 minutes. When would you apply?
As soon as the archive logs arrive.
What that does mean
is it is not guaranteed zero data loss. In the worst possible case, which would be where your primary database were destroyed 9.5 minutes after the forced log switch, and it proved to be impossible to get that last bit of redo across, yes, you would lose that 9.5 minutes of work.